Hey guys, Doc Saturday, although I'm filming on a Friday, on a fairly rough day, sort of red end to the week. Most of the downside has been today, 3% or so down, and about £6,000 down for the week. Sort of fairly spread over a lot of stocks, as you can see, except Shell, because it's a rock and just sits there around about £25 for the most part, sort of up and down a couple of pound at the moment with the oil price. We have had not too much news this week, but we've had Jerome Powell's favourite inflation measure was sort of expected to be high, although it did sort of beat expectations, 0.6% on the core PCE. So yeah, expecting him to sort of be on the warpath and raising rates, and yeah, spec stocks are sort of gonna have a bit of a bad time of it. Yeah, not a huge amount of news other than that. So I thought, as we've had quite a lot of my holdings report their earnings, I would go through some of those. I do sort of, because I'm not in a huge amount of big US tech, the earnings season does sort of come a fair bit later for me. So yeah, let's have a look at Stellantis. One that I sort of think doesn't really get anywhere near as much attention as it really should do. It's sort of one of the old guard automotive companies, car companies, and yeah, people sort of see it as, you know, not a hot stock like Tesla, even though sort of they're behind, obviously, but not tremendously behind, and sort of growing a hell of a lot. Global battery electric vehicle sales up 41% for the year. I think that was 288,000, so pretty decent. And yeah, looking at their sort of summary of their figures, revenue up 18%, which is pretty nice, and net profit up 26%, so 16.7 billion euros for a, I think they're 57 billion market cap now, so rather a nice PE ratio still, even though it's up a fair amount. You've also had free cash flow up. I guess they're sort of not putting quite so much money to work. They are obviously spending a lot of money on upgrading factories and buying companies and sort of doing joint ventures. But yeah, they have been able to sort of just increase prices, as we'll see. And yeah, that basically all goes down to profit. You can sort of come down to the breakdown per country, and you can sort of see Europe is down on sales, but sort of slightly up on revenue. Profit sort of increased slightly, and Europe is basically sort of the worst of the results. North America actually grew, which is, I thought, was really good. Sort of expecting ICE sales to be, internal combustion engine sales to be sort of falling, really, but they've, you know, sales falling and revenue increasing as they're putting the prices up. But yeah, to see North America actually bring in a small increase was pretty good. And then a fair amount of increase in revenue, nearly 70 billion up to 85 billion euros in revenue. Operating margin up a little, 10 basis points. Operating income itself up quite a bit, 20%. So yes, rather nice. But then coming down to some of the others, I sort of mentioned this last earnings, the sort of Middle East and South America and people like them are just getting gouged really for prices. Sort of shipments up slightly for both, but revenue up a reasonable amount. Revenue up 50% in South America, But if you look at operating income, up nearly 100% in Middle East and Africa, and South America, up over 100%, up 132%, primarily due to increased net revenue and favourable FX. And yeah, they call it strong operating leverage. I call it jacking the price up because they can. So, interesting. China, slightly down on shipments and sort of slightly increased on revenue. So, yeah, China sort of not really their strongest market, which is a shame because they're the biggest electric vehicle market. So we do need to be sort of pushing for China if we can. Looks like they sort of do reasonably well with Jeep and the Ram trucks. So it would be nice to get some of the sort of European brands over there if we can. And then the sort of nice to have, Maserati as a sort of premium brand, slightly up on shipments, quite a bit up on revenue, and 100% up on operating income. So rather nice. And they give a little summary of their very, very strong net cash position. So this is sort of what I think sets them apart from a lot of the other old guard manufacturers, as we'll call them, sort of Ford and Volkswagen, sort of various others, Mercedes, that they've all got a huge amount of debt. So obviously they've all got to be looking at sort of retooling factories to push towards EVs rather than combustion engine. But also a lot of the old guys have got a huge amount of debt, so doing this sort of restructuring costs a lot of money and will probably mean sort of taking out more debt. And with rising interest rates, or even, you know, just high interest rates if they're staying as they are, that's not something you really want to have. But Stellantis, sort of 33.5 billion in billion euros in debt last year. Moved down to 28 billion for June last year, and has come down to 27 billion. So still a little bit of debt, but it's coming down, which is quite nice. And cash was 49 billion, went to 46, and has stayed sort of basically as is. So with the debt reducing, up to 23 billion net cash. And there's a little bit of cash in the financial services side. So 25.7 billion euros net cash. So if you deduct sort of a fair amount of that off the market cap, then you get to sort of a price to earnings ratio net of cash of under 3, I believe, which is incredible, really, for sort of this sort of growing revenue. I think, you know, if sort of Google or someone were putting up these numbers, people would be singing from the rooftops. But it's an unloved, you know, old guard car company, so people just don't like it. But I do. Then we've got Rio Tinto. So I did the other miners of mine last week, and Rio Tinto are a little bit later. So yeah, we've got a summary of their results, looking reasonably good. Operating cash flow, they like to show sort of first, is down from last year, but slightly up on 2020. Obviously this sort of largely follows the iron ore price, really. But yeah, still a hell of a lot of operating cash flow, allowing them to beef up operations, 6.7 billion in capex basically, and yeah, free cash flow 9 billion, not too bad, 26 billion in underlying EBITDA, and yeah, net cash position has sort of gone into a debt position from a sort of slightly net cash. So Yeah, that's a shame. Looks like it's all reduction in cash, I think it was. People getting a little bit worked up as well about the dividend drop. I think you have to remember that this sort of a good part of this what is it, £10.40 was a special dividend. It wasn't sort of proper dividend yield, as some people are calling it. Sort of yeah, special dividend was for an exceptional 2021, basically, and sort of was not expected to be maintained. So it's not really, it is a cut because it was I think it was about £7 and or $7, and it's coming down to $4.92, but yeah, it's still sort of what is it, 8% or so. So I don't see that as an issue. I quite like that a lot of the UK companies sort of aren't wedded to how much they pay, basically. It's sort of pay the money when it's there, and when it isn't, then it gets cut rather than sort of being wedded to it and just sort of constantly increasing at small amounts, even when you can't afford it, which the US tend to do, and they like their dividend aristocrats and that sort of thing. I'm quite happy for companies to cut it when necessary. Often means you end up getting a bargain because everyone panics. But yeah, looking at the breakdown, this is always going to be harsh compared to comparing to 2021. Obviously, a bumper year. So underlying EBITDA for iron ore down from 27 billion to 18 billion, so 33% down. Aluminium didn't have quite as bad a drop, down 16%. Copper down 40. That really did sort of rock it up, although it's looking reasonably good so far this year. But yeah, down to 2.3 billion, and minerals, the sort of diamond side and that sort of thing, down 7%. So that's a little bit more stable and sort of slightly different earnings figures for sort of differentiation in depreciation and tax and that sort of thing. Oh yeah, so the earnings are after all that. So as you can see, similar to Vale, really, it's very, very much an iron ore miner with sort of a few side projects, and they're looking to sort of get into more, increase some of this, increase certainly the copper, but they would very much like to get into lithium as well, but that's going to be a long way away. So essentially, it's an iron ore miner. So a couple of REITs. I don't look at the REITs all that much because they're sort of a lot more stable than my other stocks, really. The earnings metrics that I tend to look at just are generally aren't that volatile. But we have had a couple of sort of reasonable moves. I do think people get a bit confused about sort of what metrics to look at, and sort of certainly when they highlight certain things, it's not always obvious. So total revenue up just over 100% to 769 million, and sort of net income up 114% year on year. Sort of all looks very nice, but obviously they've diluted a huge amount of shares to grow this revenue and net income. So any buyers that haven't sort of increased their holding now have a smaller piece of the pie, if you like. But the pie is growing, so you have a smaller piece of a larger pie. Basically, sort of if the shares that they're issuing allow them to sort of buy a property that sort of adds more value than the existing portfolio, then the dilution was worth it, basically. So you really want to go on a per share basis. And so on a per share basis, net income increased 41%, but you don't really want to use net income because of the sort of depreciation on REITs. So you want a funds from operations or adjusted funds from operations, which again, You don't want just a straight number. You want year-on-year, on a per-share basis, either year-on-year or quarter-on-quarter. So adjusted funds from operations up 15% year-over-year to 51 cents for the quarter. So that is basically the key number that you generally want to be looking at. Obviously, you can look at their debt side of things and see sort of how they're doing, how they're leveraged. If we've got interest rates coming up, they're not going to like that. And you would sort of look how much of their debt sort of matures in the next couple of years, how much is going to get rolled on to higher rates. If it's all in, you know, 30-year treasuries that aren't going to expire anytime soon, then all is well, but they generally aren't. So you have to sort of consider that. Yeah, you can see the balance sheet, obviously sort of investments increasing hugely, total assets up 17 billion to 37 billion, so over 100%, rather nice, but debt sort of increasing quite a lot, 4.6 billion to 13.7, and yeah, if you come down to the next page, you can see the number of shares up from 637 million diluted up to 965 million. So is that a sort of 50% increase in diluted shares? But if all the figures, all the other figures are to be taken into account, it looks like it was money worth spending, because they've made over 50%, sort of getting on for 100% in a lot of their measurements. So a 50% dilution was worth it, you'd say. You can have a quick sort of rough check of US only, unfortunately, REITs on Seeking Alpha, just to sort of give you an idea of sort of the REIT equivalent of PE, which would be sort of price to FFO, funds from operations, and Seeking Alpha give you that on a forward basis, which is quite handy. So yeah, they're showing 149 for Vici, so it gives it a price to FFO, or essentially PE ratio, of 22 on a forward basis, which is quite a lot. This was sort of a lot, obviously a lot lower down when the stock was a lot lower down. They were sort of in the mid to high 20s, and earnings sort of, yeah, have obviously gone up since then, but not quite as much as the stock. And yeah, well, back when it was sort of in the low 20s and high teens, it was looking like an incredible buy. But sort of 22, I do start to wonder, and be sort of comparing it to other REITs. So you take someone like Stag Industrial, sort of forward P to FFO of 15. You know, even some of the sort of premium ones that didn't used to be anywhere near this, they were sort of in the mid 20s. Even American Tower is at 16, and Digital Realty Trust, one of my others, is also also at 16. So 22 for a casino, potentially, you know, slightly more risky REIT. Obviously, in the casino side, it's always going to be a little bit of risk there. But yeah, maybe slightly overvalued. But I'm not sure I really want to sort of be selling and redistributing. So probably just hold on to it. And speaking of American Tower, they've had their earnings. So nice little sheet that they give you here. Yeah, you've got sort of similar metrics to Vici, sort of largely useless, unless you take into account the dilution. So yeah, come down to consolidated FFO, and yeah, per share, you've got 218 last year for the quarter, up to 246, so 12.8% in increase in adjusted funds from operations, and attributable to common stockholders. So they've got a little bit of income sort of going elsewhere. So common stockholders 210 up to 234. So 11.4% increase, or 15.2 on the constant currency basis. I sort of mentioned last week that I would look at this. A lot of people don't like the constant currency basis, generally because they sort of say it's cheating and people only sort of highlight it when it's more favourable to them. But I think I would try and sort of look at this when the FX isn't going in our favour as well. You know, if the numbers were reversed, then if it's 15% in sort of normal earnings, but sort of 11% in on a constant currency basis, then that is really the one you want to be looking at. So if they offer it, I always say the constant currency basis measurements are the one to look at, assuming they do show you when the numbers are reversed. Can't imagine that would sort of go away, but yeah, I would say look at those figures in the good times and the bad. But yeah, on the yearly, slightly smaller numbers. So it's just been an exceptional quarter for the full year, sort of up 3.5% or 5.6% FFO on a constant currency basis. So yeah, looking rather nice. As I say, we've got largely everything sort of down in various degrees in the portfolio. One thing I am sort of considering at the moment is the silver miners. So we've had First Majestic Silver come down below my price. I think I haven't been in the red on this since I bought it in early 2020. I think it was one of the first shares that I bought on trading 212. So yeah, over 2 years, 2.5 years, I think I've had that sort of in various levels of green, sometimes 100%, and I never took the profit, so bigger fool me maybe. But yeah, I still like silver going forward, so not sure. Unsure whether to be sort of taking a little bit out of this treasury's position quite so soon, but I do also have to consider these potentially aren't going to look quite as attractive at the current rates that I've got them at if the Fed are going to put up rates and sort of keep them at, you know, 5.5%, 6% for longer. And considering the Treasury's ETF pretty much hasn't gone down, I've only sort of lost 80 odd pound at the moment, and the dividends sort of payouts for it, I think, are going to be paid out next month. Whether it sort of drops on, I guess it still has an ex-dividend date. Presume it would drop then, but I would be entitled to a dividend or sort of payout, distribution, whatever they want to call it. But yeah, not sure whether to be sort of maybe taking a little bit out of that and adding to some of the silver miners. I've got Pan American Silver in the other ISA. So yeah, don't really have money to be putting in that though, and I've only got the four holdings, so don't think I'd be buying Pan American. Chinese tech sort of basically following the Nasdaq tech stocks. But yeah, let me know what you think on silver, if you're sort of into the commodity itself, into buying coins and that sort of thing, or if you like the miners, or just what else you're buying this week, if you're buying anything on the red dip. So yeah, leave your thoughts in comments below, and like and subscribe. See you soon.